In this segment, I will be continuing my exploration into the other formal aspects of work of art and how artists use them as a strategy to convey various meanings. Now, if I ask you how you came here, and then normally people would say I came by bus, car, whatever, but nobody will tell the full story. In the sense, I got out of my house, I opened the gate, one step left, then a cat came. So it doesn't work like that. You don't narrate things in real time. It doesn't work. You normally edit whatever you want to say. The experience happened for maybe 45 minutes, 1 hour of your journey from your home to this place, but you edit it. And you narrate the story that is most important, you think is the other listener wants to listen. Maybe if there is an accident on the place, or somebody who had heavily drunk sitting next to you, maybe that you will mention that. Or if there was some kind of traffic jam, you will mention that. Otherwise, you think rest of the details are not important. Now, Andy Warhol made a movie. He was fond of criticizing the kind of language that the Hollywood movies generate. So he made a movie of Empire State Building for 8.5 hours. He put the camera, and then the Empire State Building, in the evening it starts, then the lights come and go and everything, but we don't have the kind of patience to look at something for that long. So real time can be very boring. So assuming that, we tend to edit, we make our own sense of time and narrate the story, and in the process you are constantly editing and creating areas of emphasis where you want to emphasize and so on. So that is the understanding of the suggestive power of the narration. And also, from time to time, you may want to talk to the other person and say, you know what happened? And then the other person will try to guess what happened, and then you fill up the gap. So you leave a lot of gaps in the narration, and the other person is actually filling that. Now, the stories can be told in many ways. You can narrate the whole story, or a large amount of it, describe it, or make a symbolic effort of it, and so on. So some of these images which I have collected for this particular segment is about how does one show violence. It can be a very, very descriptive kind of imagery or a photograph. And this was the Rajiv Gandhi's assassination photograph, which is like you see everything. Or this is a piece of cloth that Mahatma Gandhi was wearing when he was shot. So just that cloth, that can tell you an entire story of what happened in that moment, or the trajectory of the building of that. Or it can be a Somnath Or paper sculpture, where he is making some marks in a Plaster of Paris slab, like as though they are wounds, and then he does a casting of that. So there can be many, many different ways of telling a story, and some people want to say as little as possible, and somebody wants to narrate it to the full. And we are trying to find out the various ways of doing that in a visual manner. Now, there were interesting advertisement campaigns which were done, and these are three stills from that. Now you go to a loo, and then you see this blood coming out. Then you become very curious. You open the door, and that is the advertisement for a Kill Bill. So that means you are creating a certain expectation from the person who is opening that, and then you reveal the most important aspect of the story. Or this was another Soprano, it's about gang wars and all that. So a similar kind of, so when that taxi is passing by, you have to observe that and then give attention. This is an installation by Anish Kapoor. It's called Shooting Into the Corner. It was displayed in the Royal Academy of Arts, London. Every 5 minutes once, this cannon would blast the colored wax onto the wall in front of it and create a different kind of patterns. And then you are waiting, and then it's over. But the way those violent things are shown to us in the movies are very different. I'll just come to that. So this is like you build up an expectation and then within a second it's over and only the trace of that will remain on the wall. And then because it's red color and all that, it builds its own narrative. This is K.G. Subramaniam. After the Bangladesh war, he made this kind of terracotta reliefs works, where he's talking about all these generals who are wearing their medals and the victim is being hung upside down, like an animal. So he's emphasizing this aspect of inhumanness of a war through this kind of imagery. And it is partly, he has made them very manneristic, in the sense you don't see the person there, but you only see his evil smile. That becomes the most important aspect of the story for him then. Or these people hanging upside down, you don't know who they are, but this, like the kind of helplessness that is shown there, that matters to him. This was one of my earlier work, where they are ready to destroy each other. So you build up a certain kind of symbolism or universal language around that, and then you comment on the act of war. This is a very interesting work where the unequalness of the power. So somebody is coming for the war with a machete and the other is coming with a gun. And then he also builds up their profile, in the sense this is from a developed world, because that person is wearing shirt and pant and his features are also like that. And this person is a local, most probably, from that area. And this becomes like a kind of island for which they are fighting. So this unequal power equation in a war, and this we can keep enlarging, in a sense, between the north and the south, developed and underdeveloped countries. So it becomes a much bigger metaphor, though the imagery is very simple. It can start making you think about the bigger aspects which happens in the present day world. And it need not be an actual war. It can be economic kind of policy that is generated by the various world institutions. In Jogen Chaudhary's drawings, sometimes he creates a certain sense of mystery. This person is evil. He is trying to go kill somebody or slash somebody, and you can see that evil intent in the eye and in this hands which are curling and then with anger and determination. But you don't see the victim, you don't see what happened from this person. For that, you'll make another drawing. If they come together in one frame, then the story is completed. By not telling the whole story, you build up a certain kind of expectation, and then you are inviting the viewer to speculate, to imagine, and to bring your own facts to the story, and then complete it. Like here, you don't know why and how and all that. We just know the witness of the act that happened. This is the child body of a child which was swept on the shores of Turkey. There's migration is a big issue in Europe. From the southern parts, they come in boats, and then midway in the sea, the boats, they can't withstand the sea, so they all die. And this one was this baby. And then no other part of the story was revealed in the picture, but it became a very iconic image. And the moment you see that, it becomes a kind of substitute for the whole story that happened around that. Migration, and then they're coming in terms of escaping poverty and coming to a land of opportunity, and how midway through they are facing death and destruction. And these are the clouds that wash out into the shores, and you don't see people. So images like this can tell very different kind of story in very emphatic way. It can become much more interesting than you show all the details. This is a IYY installation, where he has created these people sitting on a inflatable boat, and they are trying to reach the shores of Europe. And it was shown in Prague, which refused to accept migrants for a very long time. So in that he made again, you know, a kind of comment on the whole system itself. Now an image like this, again it just leaves you the traces of what happened, but no other part of the story is revealed. It can be a very intriguing kind of way of narrating a story. And then it goes forward. An artist like Lucio Fontana, for him slashing the canvas becomes a kind of act which embodies his intention to cut something, and the anger and all that. And then sometimes he takes nail kind of tool, and then he makes holes in the canvas. So a story can be a very suggestive story. Sometimes we talk about people. I saw them going together. Just that one line. I saw them together. Over. So in that one sentence, you are suggesting much more than what you are saying. That is these are the visual, way of bringing up that kind of suggestion into a narration. Now, we all know that, the cartoons are quite violent. And children see them, but you don't see blood there, but most of the cartoons are quite violent in the sense. But it's made to look like a child's play. And this is a shop which, made this kind of display of actually what happens if you take the story further and start showing all the details. And then many people felt very disturbed because their favorite cartoons were being butchered in a sense. It was shown as a violent act, and people could not digest that. These two are very iconic images, because when I show this image, that lady is not actually sitting on that, calligraphy pens. It's sharp, and in your mind, how it hurts if she sits there. You are filling this gap. The artist has not done it. So that is the power of suggestion, where you can invite the viewer to complete the story and make a much powerful impact of that. And this was an installation in Europe, this artist Marco Evaristi. This golden fish, which you normally keep in your houses as a kind of decorative fish. You don't eat that. And that he had put up in the mixie, and then it was displayed in these blenders. That's all. But it created a huge controversy. People said, you are being cruel, you are being, violent and all that. He said, no, I am not cruel, I am not violent. It is the one, you, who is actually imagining that the mixie will be switched on, and then all that fish will become an orange color liquid. So it's a very different kind of image, or a different kind of situation that you are creating, compared to showing everything like how we saw in the earlier image. So this is the kind of strategy that the artists use to make it more powerful, more impactful. Now an image like this can talk so much more about, the censorship, not allowing people to speak and so on. And it sounds very relevant for our time. So an image like this can travel beyond that specific event. That is the beauty of this kind of image, because it has a certain universality to that image. And this is at a very fundamental level, it can convey a very powerful message. Now I'm moving on to another aspect of what artists do. You know the quality of certain objects, and that quality of that object or that expectation is combined, that is fused with another object. For example, here, balloon is very fragile. One prick and it is gone. But this artist has built an entire tank with that. And by doing that, there is a commentary about, even though you have all the defense system and all, at some point it just doesn't work. So there is a commentary that comes in, because another material is being used in the place of the steel that is used for the tank. And this particular work, it looks like cake, but it is actually made in fiberglass and all that. So in that, there is a very different kind of connotation. This was an ad about AXN, and nobody would dare sit on this kind of sofa, which is filled with serpents and all that. And then with my students, when I had done an exercise, how do you design a chair for your enemy? This was the kind of imagery that came about. Now, Dali has done it, Merritt Oppenheim has done it. So artists like this kind of surprises which come because one kind of quality of an object is fused and it is merged with another kind of quality and thereby bringing a very unexpected kind of result from that or a very unexpected kind of feeling in the viewer. This is Robert Gober. This kind of sculpture is made in wax and then he is from the field where they do special effects. So the hair and all is stitched and it looks quite realistic, but it looks like a sack. So it can become a very, you know, philosophical kind of understanding of the human body. And then Bala, again, we saw the another work in an earlier presentation. It is his own body that is cast, but it is like a tube without air. So that means this body, which is like a sack, and then, you know, there are philosophical implications when you start seeing this kind of image. Mona Hathum, in many of her works, she combines again the familiar material and how they look or what they're supposed to look, and then combines them with very unfamiliar or what you don't see as a normal image. Here, this all the ceramic made from ceramic and wood. They look like toys because they're colored, they're shiny, they're very attractive, and so on. But the image that is coming through is a hand grenade. So it's a, and then by bringing that tone of a playfulness, then you also start suggesting how wars are, you know, played out as though it is, you know, a big country's playground, and then and with all the drone and everything that is involved in today's war, it starts becoming like a political commentary. So Surendra Nair combines a traditional kind of image with a modern, or sometimes with an animal or a bird image with a human figure, and thereby there is this kind of surprise that comes into his imagery. Now I move on to another segment, this idea of a distortion. So when you say distortion, the distortion can happen at various levels. I can take the shape and distort it, I can distort color, I can distort texture. So whatever is not the kind of representation or normal representation can be thought of as a distortion. And then artists have used this again and again to convey a sense of troubled inner being. Now, if I distort the human figure, it can start becoming a visual equivalent for the inner emotions which are very troubling. Maybe that person is angry inside, and all that kind of connotations will start coming. And Souza was very good in this kind of imagery where it really became a disturbing image, but the image itself was being created because he wanted to convey that. This is James Southin. The way he, you know, distorts the body and the proportion and all, you start looking at the body in a very different way. This is Somnathor. Somnathor, he saw the famine in Bengal, where lakhs of people died and they were starving and all that. And that one imagery of emaciated people, emaciated animals, has become a leitmotif. That means something that will repeat, that will recur in his images again and again. So he does people who are very bony and then without much muscles and all that. And Giacometti also brings a very close kind of imagery in that. The kind of indecisiveness in his image, and that becomes a kind of visual parallel for the indecisive nature of the person itself. He cannot decide where to actually draw the line. And but at the end of it, you get a sense of the person, but not like a representational drawing. So by altering the way a drawing is made and by distorting, you can start conveying very powerful images. Now here, André Darain distorts the color of the image. Normally, we tend to assume that the sky has to be blue, the water has to be blue, and so on. But actually, the sky can be in very different shades, or the sea can also be in very different colors. And also, there is a certain kind of freedom that he is gaining for himself. And then the studies have shown that many animals cannot see the colors that we see. So what we see as a real color, a true color, depends on the light and the kind of cones that you have. We have three cones, but there are some animals who they have only two cones. They see only in grays. And there are some animals who can see more than us. So the question is, what is the real? So that one question keeps coming back again and again. Now, just one more twist on the idea of distortion. The distortion can be also a hyperbole. I can exaggerate the story, and then such a big traffic jam. It was like 4 kilometers. It would have been only one road or two roads. But to make a point, you tend to say, it was so big. I took like 1 hour. 10 minutes would have waited there. But it felt like 1 hour. Now, when you're waiting for somebody, the time doesn't pass so easily. So how does one convey that kind of thing? And then this is Bhupen Kakkar's. He liked the Hindi movies and the way they show, all this action scene and all that. And nowadays in some of the movies, you see how the bullet is moving, then it's entering the body, the blood coming out. So actually the violent act has become a spectacle. It is no more, you don't feel aversion to it. You don't feel, I don't want to see this kind of scene. So you make a spectacle out of it. So he's in a way commenting on that. This person is, and then it's all, the whole inner is coming out. Now this is Kamath's work. Kamath, this is actually a work about an intellectual. And he is vomiting, and this vomit had this Swarovski diamond set in that. So he's so intelligent, even when he's vomiting, there's some precious thing coming out of it. So it's a very sarcastic kind of comment on the intellectuals. One more work from him, this idea of hyperbole. How much can I, keep stacking on one above the other, where the breaking point comes through? So that is the proverbial last straw which breaks the camel. So he's almost reached till there. And then you will also see that it's like an inner joke. He has used all the other artists' work. You will find the urinal we saw in another presentation. You will see Ravindra Reddy's work, and you will see many other artists' work. And only if you know the artist, then you realize, okay, he's taking from here, taking from there, and then making a big statement out of that. This is the last slide in this segment. This is Anthony Gamble's work. He uses human figure in various ways to communicate this idea of, as an individual separate from outside, and the various ways one can conceive the human condition. These terracotta figurines were made by people who don't know how to sculpt. So he would go to an ordinary man and tell him, make a human figure. And lots of people participated, and all of them are done. And then the entire floor of the gallery is filled with that. So this is in a way a sense of hyperbole. That means, there's so many of them, the volume and the scale of the density, that becomes a part of the statement that the artist is giving. It can be, an image like this can be interpreted in many ways. You can talk about human population, or various kinds of conclusions can be made, but the impact such an installation makes, you will not forget it. And thereby it becomes a memorable work. See, one challenge that any artist has got, how do I make it a very interesting work, very powerful work? So each artist finds his own strategy. And then we saw how many artists use many different kinds of strategies. It can be scale, it can be distortion, fusion, and so on, to find a voice to what they want to say. If you have enjoyed watching this video, please press like button. To see more such videos, subscribe to our channel. Thank you.